Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom, people still coming in. Please turn to your neighbor, say hello, introduce yourself, wish them Shabbat Shalom. Ask them how the week went. That's it? It was fast. Well, thank you to those who prepared delicious dinner. I'm sure everyone enjoyed it. Tonight you'll see that we are lighting 3 candles. We've been doing this since October 7th. We're lighting the 3rd candle. We add another light to Shabbat to remember those who were taken hostage, and also to make a statement that we are standing in solidarity with Israel. Additional light also represents our resilience and our perseverance as Jewish people. And as we embrace Shabbat, we light Shabbat candles, and I invite Abby and Marsha to help light the candles. Page 120.
As these Shabbat candles give light to all who behold them, so may we, by our lives, give light to all who behold us. As their brightness reminds us of the generations of Israel who have kindled light, so may we, in our own day, be among those who kindle light.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher Kitchano B'mitzvotah Mitzvahim Ad Lichner Shel Shabbat.
Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, Sovereign of the universe, who hallows us with mitzvah, commanding us to kindle the light of Shabbat.
Please join me in singing. Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu to page 123, and if it's your custom, I invite you to rise for the Kiddush, and Marlene Gordon will lead us in Kiddush. And tonight we have Louise Ornstein, who will be leading Shabbat service with me.
Baruch Adonai Eloheinu Melech Olam Re'beri ha'gafen Baruch Atadonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam Asher kitchanu b'mitzvotah Horatza lanu V'shabbat kadsho Yahava u'retzon hin chilanu Zikaro limaseh bereishit Ki hu yom tefila lo mikrei kodesh zecher letziat mitzrayim ki banu ahata Shecha, Yahava Uratzon, Hinchaltanu, Baruch Atarnai, Mika.
Thank you, Marlene. Please be seated.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
We began with Hinei Matov, and how wonderful and pleasant it is when brothers and, let's say, sisters can live together as one. That's become pretty hard to do within the Jewish community, at least as we deal with the highly charged issues surrounding the war in Gaza. I'd like to share a very short story with you. There once was an old man who was walking down a beach that was filled with starfish, thousands and thousands of them, all struggling to make it back into the water, which was their home. A small boy walking along the beach saw the old man throwing the starfish one by one back into the water. The boy said to the old man, "Excuse me, sir, but there are thousands and thousands of starfish here. Do you think that you can possibly make a difference? Seems rather hopeless, and I think most of them will die." The old man looked up as he threw another one back in the water, and he said to the boy, "I made a difference to this one." And then he threw another starfish back in, and to this one, and this one. Imagine the difference that we could make if, instead of criticizing, disagreeing, we'd work together. And together, the old man and the boy continue to return the starfish to the sea. Even in these trying times, when opinions vary and differences often feel so overwhelming, we can make a difference. We can build a more cohesive community, one starfish at a time. Please join me on page 124 in the middle, and we'll read together. May the door of this synagogue be wide enough to receive all who hunger for love, all who are lonely for friendship. May it welcome all who have cares to unburden, thanks to express, hopes to nurture. May the door of this synagogue be narrow enough to shut out pettiness and pride, envy and enmity. May the threshold be no stumbling block to young or straying feet. May it be too high to admit complacency, selfishness, and harshness. May this synagogue be, for all who enter, the doorway to a richer and more meaningful life.
Continue on page 138. Please join me in singing from the Hadadi. And we sing verses 1, 2, 5, and 9.
Me.
seated. And please join me in singing of Tov Lehodot on page 140. Page 144. Please join me in chanting of Hatzi Kaddish.
Yit Kadal, Yit Kadash Meraba, Bel Maribera Hirote, Beamlig Mahote, Behaye Hanu, Beamehan, Uhaye de Hobet Israel, Ba.
We rise for our call to worship, page 146.
Historically, night has been a scary time. We can't see because of the darkness, and therefore, we're more vulnerable to unknown dangers. Imagine what the first night must have been like for Adam and Eve. When the light disappeared, did they wonder if it ever would return? They'd enjoyed the warmth and beauty of the Garden of Eden, and then it was gone. and they were plunged into darkness and coldness. The Ma'ariv Aravim prayer reminds us that even though it is night, day will always follow. Even though it's a frigid winter, spring will surely come. There's a predictable and an eternal order, a rhythm to change. Things do not stay the same. We need not remain in a state of fear. Just as light follows day, so too does hope follow despair. Please join me at the top of page 148 in the Hebrew. I'm sorry, I think it's 149. No, 148. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher divaro ma'ariv aravim, v'chochma poteach she'arim, uv'dina mechina itin, u'mehalef et hazmanim, u'mesader et hakochavim, v'mishmerotechem barakia kirtzono, borei yom v'laila, golel or mipnei hoshech, v'hoshech mipnei or. Umavi laila, umavdil bin yom uven laila, Adonai tzvaot shemo. El hai v'kayam tamid, yimloch aleinu le'olam va'ed, Baruch ata Adonai, ha'ma'ariv aravim. Then we continue on page 151. At the top, together please. As you taught Torah to those whose names I bear, teach me Torah too. Its mystery beckons, yet I struggle with its truth. You meant Torah for me, did you mean the struggle for me too? Alone. Be wise to listen, to know. Lead me into the mystery. Baruch atah Adonai, Ohev Amo Yisrael.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem, Kevod Malchuto, Leolam Vaed.
Please be seated.
Shartam lehot ayadecha, v'hayu letotafot b'ineneha, uchtachtam al mezuzot b'itecha v'sharecha, v'man tizkiru v'asitem, v'item kirushim l'Elohem, ani Adonai. Yod lahem lalakim, ani Adonai Elohim.
Adonai Elohim, Emet. We'll read responsively, beginning in the middle of page 157. In a world torn by violence and pain, a world far from wholeness and peace, give us the courage to say, Adonai, there is one God in heaven and earth.
I haven't declared.
From bondage in Egypt, we were delivered, and at Sinai, we bound ourselves to your way. Though our failings are many and our faults are great, It has been our glory to bear witness to God, keeping alive in dark ages your vision of a world redeemed.
Let us continue to work for the day that nations will be one and at peace.
We continue together in the middle of page 161. Give us a place to rest, Adonai, our God. Bring us into shelter in the soft, long evening shadows of your truth. For with you are true protection and safety, and in your presence are acceptance and gentle love. Watch over us as we go forth. Prepare for us as we return. Spread over us your shelter of peace. All we love over our Jerusalem and yours. Baruch atah Adonai, haporei sukkah shalom.
Please join me with the Shamro on page 160.
The Shamro Bene Israel.
Center of our service, the Tefillah, page 164. Please rise.
Adonai sevata kita ofia yitei lateha. Adonai, open up my lips that my mouth may declare your praise. Baruch ata Adonai. Elohei Abraham, Elohei Yitzhak, Elohei Yaakov. karnehakol zocher vazdei avot v'imachot mevigil lalib nevinehem leman shemo be'ahava melech ozer u'moshiyah u'magen baruch ata Adonai magen Avraham v'ezrat Sarah ata gibor le'olam Adonai mechaye hakol ata rok u'moshiyah Mashiv haruach u'morid chag Hashem mechokel chayim be'esed mehaye hakol berachamim rabim samech noflim berofech olim u'matir asurim u'mekahaye emunato lishene yachar michamot habagiburot מלך ממית ומחייה ומצמיח ישוע ונאמן אתה להיות הכל ברוך אתה אדוני מחייה הכל אתה קדוש ושמך קדוש וקדשים בהיום יעוללו הסלע ברוך אתה אדוני האל הקדוש.
Please be seated.
We continue together at the top. We continue together at the top of page 173. May these hours of rest and renewal open our hearts to joy and our minds to truth. May all who struggle find rest on this day. May all who suffer find solace. May all who hurt find healing on this day. May all who despair find purpose. May all who hunger find fulfillment on this day. And may this day fulfill its promise. Baruch Ata Adonai Mekadesh HaShabbat.
Continue with the singing of Ratzeh.
Please join me at the top of page 177 as we offer gratitude to God for the gift of life and all that it enriches. God of goodness, we give thanks for the gift of life, wonder beyond words, to the awareness of soul or light within, to the world around us so filled with beauty, for the richness of the earth which day by day sustains us. For all these and more, we offer thanks. Baruch Atah Adonai HaTov Shimcha Ulachan El Lahodot.
Shalom Rav.
Take a few moments for silent prayer, some reflection. The Shabbat of our hearts are in the East, and I invite you to read with me, to pray with me on page 13 in our booklets, a prayer for compassion, Let's join together as one congregation. Page 13. Blessed oneness, blessed connection, Kadosh Baruch Hu, we pray for all who are in pain and who are caused pain. We pray for those of us who are so angry, we have lost compassion for the suffering, for anyone who is not a member of our group. We pray for those of us who cannot see the suffering, heard the loss, connection. We pray for strength to resist the urge. We pray for the courage to resist the calls of inhumanity that others may make upon us in time of crisis. Blessed one is blessed connection, Kadosh Baruch Hu. May we find relief for our hearts and tears. May we not be in pain. Amen. This moment we pray for those in our community who are in need of healing, healing of body and healing of spirit. And when my eyes meet your eyes, please say the name of the person who is in need of healing. And those at home. We pray for those in our community, Shana Esther Batruchel, Laura Braun, Rini Feingel, Michael Shortak, Valerie Brownstein, Stephen Brigger, Carol Brigger, Linda Champion, Raymond Condon, Jen Palmer, Lynn Sharfman, Yoel David, Ben Mordechai, Kim Stanger DeLizzle, Alan Skirker, Daniel Linzer, Lou Jones, John Berman, Jeff Wicks, Genevieve Russo, Asher Ben Hirsch, Vafega, Randall Hemps, Teresa Elizabeth Schwoll, Helen Naftali, Rosalind Elgais, Eitan Lipson. We pray for Israeli hostages that have been kept in Gaza. We pray for their speedy return. We also pray for all innocent people who suffer and who are in despair in the region. I invite you to join with me as we sing together or guide my steps on page 677. 677. Steps and help me find my way. I need your shelter now. Rock me in your arms and guide my steps and help me make each day a song of praise to you. Rock me in your arms and guide my steps. Guide my steps.
Our parsha this week is Toldot, comes from the book of Genesis. The books of Genesis and Exodus are where most of our Bible stories come from. They're the foundational story of our people. Whether they are historically true or not is the subject of another sermon, or two, or three, or four. But historically accurate or not, Their lessons convey great truths and insights, which can inform how we live our lives Jewishly. One might think that a foundational story such as this should feature nothing but heroic characters, and there is no shortage of heroes in the Torah. However, the books of Genesis and Exodus could easily be read as a textbook on family dysfunction. We see repeated instances of dishonesty and deceit, poor examples of parenting, sibling rivalry, and much, much more. Now, anyone who has a brother or sister can certainly recall a time when you felt like killing him or her. Here is my story. My brother Gabe is 9.5 years younger than I am. This story took place at my confirmation ceremony. So I was about 16 years old and he was about 6. As is true of many confirmation services, they can be quite long. And as the service was nearing its end, Gabe was getting very antsy. My mom leaned over to him and whispered, "Gabriel, it's almost the end. In a few minutes, we'll go and have cookies and juice. See if he can sit still for just a few more minutes." As if on cue, the rabbi then got up to address the confirmants, and as rabbis are wont to do, he said, referring, of course, to our Jewish learning, "I want you to realize that this is not an end. It is only a beginning." You can guess. And my brother yelled out at the top of his lungs, "Mommy, you said it was the end," and he said, "It's just the beginning." So I don't let him forget that. It's many, many years ago. I could have strangled him. I was mortified, as only a 16-year-old could be. By the way, my brother also couldn't understand or accept the fact that he couldn't drive a car. He was 6 years old, I was 16, but if I could, he should be able to, right? Okay, so in the books of Genesis and Exodus, we are treated to repeated examples of problems that arise from sibling rivalry and from poor communication. Take the very first brothers, Cain and Abel. Cain kills Abel because God accepts Abel's offering and does not accept Cain's. Cain is overwhelmed by jealousy and anger, and he commits the first murder ever. He kills his brother Abel. In our parsha tonight, we have the story of Jacob and Esau. We will talk more about them in a minute, but for right now, it's enough to say that each of their parents, Isaac and Rebekah, favors a different one of the sons. And this leads to a situation in which Esau, probably understandably, becomes so jealous and angry that he threatens to kill Jacob. And then, of course, we have the story of Joseph and his brothers. Joseph is clearly his father's favorite son. The brothers become so jealous and enraged at this situation that they decide to kill Joseph. They wind up just selling him into slavery. Are you picking up a theme here? Jealousy and rage. So you probably know the basics of the Jacob and Esau story. Rebecca becomes pregnant with twins, and while they are still in her womb, the twins, Jacob and Esau, are already fighting. In desperation, Rebecca appeals to God, who tells her that the two boys she's carrying will grow up to be leaders of different nations, which will be at war with one another. And the older son, Esau, older by a matter of a minute or two, will serve the younger one, Jacob. This is definitely not the way that things are supposed to go. Now the father, Isaac, favors his son Esau, who, because he is older, should therefore receive the birthright and the blessing of God passed down to the patriarchs. Rebekah favors Jacob, and she received that message from God that even though Jacob is younger, he should receive the blessing. And so Rebekah plots to trick Isaac into bestowing the blessing intended for Esau upon Jacob. Isaac is very old and blind and probably suffers from PTSD after nearly being sacrificed. And sure enough, he falls for the subterfuge. Once the blessing has been bestowed upon Jacob, Esau arrives, and it is only then that Isaac realizes what has happened. He tells Esau that since he has already bestowed blessing on Jacob, it cannot be undone. Weeping, Esau begs, "Father, have you only one blessing?" Isaac manages to give a blessing to Esau as well, but it pales in comparison to the one given to Jacob, and it includes the fact that Esau will serve his brother, and that this service will be a yoke around his neck. Esau becomes enraged and threatens to kill Jacob. Rebekah then convinces Isaac that Jacob should leave home in order to find a wife. By the way, this discussion is one of the very few that we are told occur between Rebekah and Isaac. But in this way, she protects Jacob from Esau's fury. Consequences of this trickery are huge. Isaac feels betrayed by Jacob. In fact, we read that Isaac trembled violently when he learns what has happened. The only other time he trembled was when Abraham had tied him up and placed him on the altar and almost sacrificed him. Esau also feels betrayed and is so angry that he threatens to kill Jacob. Rebekah must send Jacob into exile to protect him, and she's deprived of the company of this son, whom she adores, for over 20 years. For Jacob, the consequences last a lifetime, leading to conflict between his wives and his children. And it was all unnecessary. Rebekah and Isaac did not communicate. Suppose that Rebekah had told Isaac about the revelation from God when it happened. There would have been no need for the deception. How might things have been different if she had shared this information with Isaac? Rabbi Jonathan Sacks, Zikrono Livracha, who happens to be one of my favorite biblical commentators, muses that Isaac might have said something like this: "Of course I know that it will be Jacob, not Esau, who will continue the covenant, but I have two quite different blessings in mind, one for each of our sons. I will give Esau the blessing of wealth and of power. May God give you the dew of heaven and the richness of earth. May nations serve you and peoples bow down to you. I'll give Jacob the blessing that God gave to Abraham and to me, the blessing of children and the promised land. May God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and increase your numbers until you become a community of peoples. May he give you and your descendants the blessing given to Abraham so that you may take possession of the land where you now reside as a foreigner, the land God gave to Abraham." Words are powerful. We must learn to use them to their greatest advantage. So much jealousy, anger, and rage can be traced back to failures in communication. Just as God created the natural world with words, and God said, "Let there be," we create our social world also with words. If we hope to create a world in which we actually want to live, one which is kind and nurturing and populated by people who can live in harmony, we must be especially cognizant to make our communications strong, honest, open, and as much as possible, kind. Without such communication, disaster is just a breath away. This often is not easy. It can be especially hard when the subject matter is highly charged. I'm thinking now of the difficulty that sometimes heated conversations take place now within the Jewish community and between the Jewish community and others about what Israel's response should or should not be to the tragedies of October 7th. Whether we are engaged in discussions like this or perhaps more personal and intimate discussions, our words matter. Allow me to offer just a few suggestions. We need to begin by listening, and listening to understand, not to prepare our next response. It's important to try our best to assume the best about the other, give them the benefit of the doubt. We get into all sorts of trouble when we assume we know another's motivations. Ask, clarity. Realize that when there is disagreement, it is very, very rare that one person is completely right and the other is completely wrong. And so it's critical that we be honest about owning our own contribution to the problem, no matter how small we may think it is. And finally, it's really important to try to provide a face-saving way for the other person to admit they are part of the problem. None of us likes to say, "You're right, I'm a jerk." We resist it like the plague. You can get a lot further by saying something like, "I know you would never intentionally hurt my feelings, so I have to believe that you didn't realize how I would hear what you said or how it would wound me." The other person doesn't have to get defensive. The message still gets through. In fact, it gets through better when the other person isn't busy trying to prove that they aren't a jerk. So the Bible does not have to be historically true to share its deepest truths with us. You must only look below the surface to learn from it. Our sages taught, turn it and turn it, for all is contained within it. May we all have the wisdom and grace to learn all that our tradition has to teach us, and thus live more fulfilling, more peaceful, and more holy lives. Can you hear us, son?
Let's turn to our booklet on page 11. Page 11, as we say the prayer, "A Guardian of Israel." And please join me. Eternal One of the universe, Guardian of Israel, be with us this time of darkness and trouble. Surround the families who have lost loved ones with your compassion. Give strength to the hostages and all who care about them, at home and afar. Grant wisdom among the leaders of Israel and courage to all who defend her and the land, air and sea. Remember your covenant with your people, Israel. Grant us peace. Say together, Amen. Please rise for Aleinu on page 586. Turn to page 598. Before we recite Kaddish Yatom, we remember those who died in recent days: Susan Feder Margulis, friend of Alan Krieger, near 40, cousin of Liz Arnstein; David Rosenzweig, father of Douglas and Deborah Rosenzweig; and Samantha Wall. If you have a name of the person who you would like to mention, you may say it now. And at home? We observe the Yortzeits in our community: Elaine Adler, Samuel Agent, Leah Albaum, Leon Allen, Sylvia Berkovich, Gerald Hatlin, William Cohn, Lillian Corto, Paula Ginsberg, Evelyn Greenfield, Maureen Highfield, James Holzbach, Eleanor Cantor Naftal, Miriam Kasik, Rob Krieger, Mary Kruskal, Celia Krushkova, Jared Levine, Linda Lieberman, Earl Lovenheim, Peter Manja, Melvin Nasner, Irving Popkin, Pia Posterov, Barbara Rubin, Richard Rudolph, Brian Salerno, Saul Skirker, Jonathan Taub, Lies Utantos, John Yasinov. We also remember all Israeli soldiers who have fallen in this war, and we remember all innocent people who died in this war. Please join me on page 598 with Kaddish Yatom Mones Kaddish. Yitkadal v'yitkadash mei rabba, Yoma tibra hirute, Hayam lich malhute, V'chai hon uv'yom adhon, V'chaye v'hol beit Yisrael, V'cholau v'zman karib, Yehei shmei rabba mavra, V'olam olme almaya, Yitbarach, Yishtabach, V'yitpa'ar, V'yitramam, V'yitnaseh, Brihu, Le'ela min kol birchata v'shirata, Tushpichata v'nehemata, Damiran ve'alma v'yidru, Amen. Yishlam ha'rabba min shemaya, V'hayim malenu kol tzayel. Oseh shalom bimromav, Hu yaseh shalom, Aleinu v'al kol Yisrael, V'al kol yoshvei tevel, V'imru, Amen. May the one who creates harmony on high bring peace to us, to all, and to all Israel. We say together, Amen. Please be seated. Well, tonight's announcements, just brief announcements. Thank you to Liz Ornstein for your wisdom and beautiful devar, and to lead the service with me. It was a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you to all who cooked the dinner. It was delicious. We appreciate your commitment. This Sunday, we have a lecture by Larry Fine. It's by reservation only. By registration, please register if you decide to attend at 9:30. You can attend on Zoom or in person, and both need registration. Our Thanksgiving service is on Thanksgiving Day at 11 a.m. at First Unitarian Church, and then also will be on Zoom. December 1st, we'll have Israeli Solidarity Shabbat, Musical Shabbat, and I hope you can join us. And all other announcements you may find on our website. Another very important announcement is to register for Hanukkah dinner. We have to remember to bring light in this darkness. So register for Hanukkah dinner, and we hope to see you for our Hanukkah festivities. I invite Mark Block, this is his loud voice, to lead us in Hamotzi. First of the blessing.
First say, well, you cut the bread, you have it, right? Baruch Ataronai, Heinu Metolam, Amotzi Lechem Min Haaretz.
Amen. Well, thank you.
Yeah.
You can eat now. So, friends, we turn to page 656. 656, this month we're trying to sing Israeli songs as closing songs. I know it's new songs for some of you, but please join as much as you can. And if you're not sure of the word, just hum. Shachor kabet kol shene vakesh lu yehi. Shabbat Shalom.
Please rise for the closing benediction.
Please rise for this closing benediction.
God of peace, as we enjoy the gift of Shabbat, a respite from the turmoil of the world, and a time for self-nurturance and renewal, remind us how important what we communicate is. Help us to be mindful of our words, to use them to build bridges of peace in our personal relationships, in our community, and within Yoshe Tevel, all the inhabitants of the world. And together we say, Amen.
Amen. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.